Howdy, everybody. We're Super Monkey Fighters, back with another What Would You Change podcast. This time, we're going to jump into Black Swan. Before I get into all of the synopsis and everything, I am Loki, here with Monkey Feathers and Papa Nugget. How you guys doing?
Pretty good.
So as I said, we're getting into Black Swan. It is the story of a committed dancer who struggles to maintain her sanity after winning the lead role in a production of Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake. Again, directed by Darren Aronofsky, written by Mark Heyman, Andres Heinz, John J. McLaughlin. Stars Natalie Portman, Mila Kunis, Vincent Cassel, Barbara Hershey, Winona Ryder shows up in it, and one other notable appearance by Sebastian Stan, who is now famous, but probably wasn't that famous back then. He is, of course, the Winter Soldier from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. What'd you guys think?
I remember seeing it in theaters 10 years ago, and I remember who I saw it with, and seeing it now again all the way through. There were things that I had a sudden epiphany of like, oh, is that what this means? But the thing that I did like about this film was I did like the twisted reality aspect of you don't know if it's real, you don't know if it's fake. And you're watching as this character is descending into essentially a madness of sorts because she's living through this pressure of living up to, I guess, Beth, who's played by Winona Ryder, who was an amazing dancer, and now she's leaving. And so now Nina has to take over this pivotal role of essentially being the lead dancer. And you're watching as she's descending into the same essential craziness of, well, now there's this understudy who's going to take my role and my position, and she's just delving into madness. And I actually really enjoyed watching that because you as an audience are left wondering, as this character is left wondering, is it real? Is it not?
For the people who tend to like it, it's a sign of a good movie is that it is different for everybody.
Yeah. With what I found really interesting was I looked at the mother and I looked at Lily, who's played by Mila Kunis. I looked at them as basically split personalities that are represented in real life of Nina, where the mother is represented as the White Swan and Lily's represented as the Black Swan. And these are two characters that she's living the White Swan life with her mother, and she's happy and perfect and everything. And then Lily comes into play, and now she's slowly succumbing to the Black Swan persona. And it just was really interesting as I was watching this that I just thought that halfway through that I thought, oh my gosh, it's like a split personality. And these two characters are her real life version of them. And so then I started wondering if the mother is a real character and if Lily's a real character, but I didn't care. It was just so fascinating to watch as it was unfolding to have that sudden thought of, is it real? Is it not? And are just this character basically living two separate lives type thing.
Yeah. And it's interesting to see that you saw that in the mother and Lily. Cause the way I see it is Nina is the White Swan and Lily is the Black Swan.
And
I think
they
showcase that very well. And Nina's mother is the thing that's trying to hold her and keep her in the White Swan. And Vincent Cassel's character in the, I guess the director of the play, the whoever's running the ballet, his character is trying to push her into being the Black Swan. I mean, that's his entire arc with her is you are perfect as the White Swan. He says it several times. You're perfect as the White Swan. You cannot lose control enough to be the Black Swan. The Black Swan is the imperfection. And that's where Lily is. She is that. She's that naturally talented, just go with the flow kind of a thing. And she doesn't do things right, but she does them interesting. Where Nina is trained. I mean, she wakes up and she starts training. I mean, the whole first half of the movie is her just continually practicing and trying to be perfect. And that's what she struggles with, is she's trying to be perfect in what she thinks is perfect, and everybody else is trying to make her something else.
Right.
You know, her mom is trying to hold her back. Even Lily is trying to push her to be, you know, to be a friend, really, is a lot of what her arc is. And I see Nina as projecting herself onto Lily a lot more, because most of her fears that involve her is the thing that she is Lily taking the thing that she wants. And where she starts to break with reality a lot more is when she starts seeing Lily is not that, right? She sees her with one of the other dancers, not with Vincent Cassel's character, and realizes that she's not actually after anything that she wants. She's just wants to be her friend, kind of a thing. She's just there as a person, not as the Black Swan. The Black Swan is really within her. So, but like I said, that's interesting to see that your take on that, where the mother is the White Swan and, you know, Lily is the Black one.
It just felt very much two different personas of Lily represented in real life and them trying to battle for control over her, basically. And I know that when you have the, I guess, credits of how they're labeled, yeah, you know, Natalie Portman is labeled as the White Swan and Mila Kunis is labeled as the Black Swan. But yeah, just in watching it, it felt very much like a White Swan and a Black Swan battling for control for dominance over a character.
Well, and if you were to assign White Swan, Black Swan roles to every character, to split them into those two things, her mom would very much be a White Swan, whereas Lily...
But she wears black the entire time.
She does wear black the entire time. I think it's more because she's not a positive, even though she would be a White Swan, she's trying to force Nina to remain a White Swan. So she's not necessarily a positive influence. Like, you know, she still has malicious intent. It's interesting to see how it is that struggle. It's one of those things that they touch on very well, that you can either pull more strongly towards as this is the meaning kind of a thing. But it is that struggle as an individual to what everyone else wants you to be. And I think that's a lot of what really just kind of tears her apart, is that she's never been able to, her mother's been so overbearing, she's never been able to really identify what she wants. And as everybody starts pulling her in different directions, she just completely loses it and is never really able as a person to develop a sense of self. And so she's always wrapped up in what she needs to be, not who she is. I do tend to like stories of people spiraling into insanity. I don't like this one as much for that. I think they do it. It's a very well-made film. They do things very well. I like the mirror scenes, not only the symbolism behind those as far as self-reflection and those kinds of things, but the way that they utilize that to creepy effect. I think I would have liked to have seen that more, and maybe they did it and it was just too subtle, but they do a very good job of utilizing that as both the symbolism and the metaphor of self-reflection, as well as disassociation, where the mirror moves but the person doesn't, kind of thing. I do like the casting choices. I think are fantastic. It's nice to have seen, because I thought of this when Mila Kunis's character is actually revealed. You see her on the train and she's mimicking the movements of Natalie Portman, and they set it up very much as if it is Natalie Portman, and then it revealed as Mila Kunis. It was nice to see a different actress and not Keira Knightley. Yeah. So, you know, where Keira Knightley was her literal double in Star Wars in the Phantom Menace, because of how similar they are, it was nice to see somebody who's different enough to not have been a direct doppelganger. Like, I think that would have been I could easily see that as having been a publicity move of, hey, they're back together again, playing the same parts. It was nice to see they didn't do that. Vincent Cassel he's one of those actors. I think he does very well in every role that he does, even though he does kind of play, he can end up playing similar parts usually, but I think he does very well in every role that he does. He has a presence that just, I think, makes scenes work. I did like I said, just more of that descent into madness and how they portrayed that. There were some scenes that were very jarring and disorienting, I think on purpose, which I think maybe helps take some people out of the film. If you can't understand spatially what's going on in the scene, like characters leave from one side and come back from another, and it doesn't make sense as to how they got there. There's a scene that stood out with that. She's looking at the statue of the Black Swan. it's very jarring where she's looking around and it's very focused on her. And then it quick cuts to someone else. And then a character who had left previously from the scene comes back in. He walks off to one side of the building and comes in from the other side very quickly, you know, within a matter of minutes in this scene, you know, or less than a minute. And so it's just very jarring as to how that would happen. But it's that way, I think, to show more of the dissociation of the main character, that she's splitting from reality more and you know, maybe lost in herself a lot, especially in that where she's trying to discover who she is. I do really like the open interpretations. There's many different ways. I think they very clearly say it's a lot of different things, and you kind of get to pick and choose which one you like the most, or it's not just one thing, where life is not always just one simple little thing. It's the story of a lot more going on. I did like that.
Like, I like the way they were trying to show, kind of, at least in my interpretation, the change of Nina kind of figuring herself out, changing, letting the black swan come out, so to speak, if that's the way you took it. That's the way I more or less took it.
Yeah.
It was great. Like, I thought the premise of it was good. To get into my thoughts on it, is I had a real, and I think this is why I have a hard time with this one, is I don't connect with the main character at all. Like, nowhere. I had a hard time following it. I mean, it's not hard to follow what's going on and even trying to piece together what they're trying to say. I think it offers a lot of room, and maybe that's my problem, is it offers a lot of room for interpretation. I think it's a very open, nothing's nailed down. You it gives you that.
Yeah.
And sure, that could be seen as a good thing. I don't see it, at least how it was done, as a good thing. And that coupled with, like, I didn't connect with anyone in the film at all. Like, it was hard. Like, I fell asleep even watching it the second time. Like, so
it's always,
yeah,
it's always a good sign of a movie.
I struggled through it.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm not, I like what they were trying to do with it. Like, don't get me wrong, that I'm just all negative about it, but
yeah,
it just didn't connect with me at all. The one issue I had, and the other thing, I didn't understand the purpose of her mother. Like, I'm really still trying to figure out, like, the purpose of where she fits into it. Yeah, she's kind of a controlling person. Maybe she's been controlling Nina. That's why Nina's like that. She's repressed, and the whole, it's finally her rebellion, right?
Yeah.
To let her black swan out. But it just didn't really do it for me. I don't know what to say other than that. Like, I get it. I see it. I see what they're trying to do. Like, it just, it landed flat for me. And I felt like, as I was watching it, I was more focused on trying to figure out what they were trying to say than like following the show.
Uh-huh.
Like, I was more in my head trying to figure it out more than just watching what was going on. So that's a big part of it.
I disliked that it kind of got into its own head a little bit. It's higher concept more than it is interesting storytelling or interesting characters. It's where the film is, I should say, the film is more about the concept of what it's trying to get across, of either going insane, trying to find perfection and going insane, or trying to break out from who you are and change yourself. And I think it's more of a forced change. There's a lot of growing up allegory. I think it's more about those than it is about the characters or the story that they're trying to tell. So that, which is why this, you know, scenes are very jarring and characters are harder to identify with within those kinds of things. I do think it's, having watched Darren Aronofsky as a filmmaker from his first films on, and the parallels between him and Christopher Nolan early on, both of their first films came out, I believe, in the same year. They were both black and white. They were both kind of a base idea that led into their next film, which I believe also came out the same year, is kind of, in my mind, their perfect film, or the most important one that they've made. Darren Aronofsky's being Requiem for a Dream and Christopher Nolan's being Memento. I think those are the films that solidified them as filmmakers that people will remember them the most for historically. They also did, in 2006, they both released a film with Hugh Jackman, which is also interesting, that is kind of one of their better made films. It's kind of their first. This is, you know, they had the budget, they had the support from the studios, and they made a very amazing film. That's kind of where they separate, though. And especially Darren Aronofsky, I think that's the point where he tips more into concept over story, and it becomes very unrelatable. It becomes very hard to follow. It's more what people would call artsy fartsy rather than interesting or entertaining. And I think this is Black Swan kind of hits that on the head a lot, where it is that concept more than it is character. It is, we're trying to make a point, and it's more symbolism than it is interesting events, those kinds of things. It does still have those interesting events, but I think it is a lot more about the concept and not about the characters or the story. So it starts to lose me there. And then I think his later films just go even more down that path. So
I had issues with The Mother. Just because it kind of falls into a cliche of a parent trying to force their own dreams onto their child. And this took it very far in that cliche, because the mother's very possessive. She's, I guess, obsessive too, because the whole scene where she's painting pictures of her daughter, and granted, you don't know if it's real or not, but I'm going to say it's real. But she's painting pictures of her daughter, and she's crying, and she's talking to the portrait, and then she's trying to control her daughter and everything that she's doing. And you can't go out and be with a friend, and you can't go and do this, and you have to, you have dance tomorrow, or you're on stage tomorrow.
You're going to be on the stage.
Yeah. It was very controlling, and it felt very cliche for me, because I see it in a lot of, I guess, movies that deal with arts, whether it's a sport movie or whether it's a dance movie or whether it's something similar. It just tends to fall into that of a cliche, where a parent's trying to force their own dreams onto the child, and then this movie didn't have it, but then at the end of the movie, the parent comes to realize, you have your own dreams and I'll let you live your own life and things like that. This didn't have that because of how it ended, but...
So I don't mean to cut you off, but before I lose track on this, I do want to ask you, so the final shot that you see her mother in, where she's in the audience, what do you think of that?
It portrayed the happy parent, like, my daughter did this and I'm so proud of her and everything that she's accomplished in this, and she was so great. So that's all I saw of it. I didn't look at it as any other twisted portrayal.
For me, that final shot kind of helps solidify more this the delusion that Nina is in, because that shot to me is more of a concerned parent. Like, everybody else is praising her and thinking there that her mother is the only one sitting there seeing, like, no, this is... nothing here is good. This is it's the first time I think she shows genuine concern for her daughter. Whereas every other time it's more, you know, she's trying to be controlling and manipulative, and she's trying to make things.
I guess the reason why. So
I think it's the first time you see her as who she really is, and not through the lens of Nina's perceptions of her as being controlling, because I see it more as she's very concerned and afraid for her daughter, and that she's the only one who understands she's watching her daughter die. So,
yeah, it's strange, because my perception of the mother throughout the whole film has very much been, you're controlling and you're obsessive and you want to basically force your dreams on your daughter. And so I never had the opportunity to have a different personality seep through to be able to say, oh, you're a concerned parent. That's what your concerned face looks like. It was more of,
well, yeah. And it's really only that scene, like that really stood out to me this time, is that her mother in that moment, whether she realizes it in the moment or that we've only ever seen her through Nina's lens, and that we've only ever seen any of the characters through Nina's lens. So we've never really seen them as they really are. So is her mother really controlling and manipulative and all of those kinds of things? Or does Nina just see her that way?
Or maybe that's the moment she realizes that she's lost control, or the control she's been trying to put on Nina. But that's the problem with this movie. We don't know anything. Because we can just make up whatever we want to think, because nothing's nailed down.
Yeah.
And that's the problem I have with it.
Well, I think that's a very valid, valid thing to bring up, because I do like an ambiguous ending. I don't like an ambiguous movie. Like, to have, oh, I can make up what anything in this means. And I do think there are some bounds within this, like, do these things mean this, that, you know, but everything being open for interpretation, just like, well, why did I watch your movie? I could just sit here and think of my own, and then I've got my own movie. So
how would you change this one then?
I don't know how I would change this one. I think, I would remove the more horror elements that do creep up in the film. There's a very definitive turn where it's kind of this slow story as she loses her mind and deals with the stress that's going on in her life, and is struggling with her ideas of perfection and how everyone else is trying to force her to change and grow up, and how life is trying to force her to change and grow up, how her mother's trying to stifle her and keep her. Her mother's trying to keep her in the idea that her mother has for her of a child and pure and innocent, and mixed with she can't be better than her mother because her mother was a dancer who had to give things up because she had a baby. She also doesn't want her to succeed, those kinds of things. So watching her slowly kind of move through that, there's a very definitive turn where they just kind of crank it up to 11, where the crazy goes big. And there's some things before that where you can kind of guess, well, this was a delusion, this wasn't, where that from that point on, everything is. And
yeah, that's, I had a hard time with all that.
Yeah, there's jump scares. There's, you know, she has a feeling in the kitchen like somebody's watching her, and then she turns the light off and back on, and there's a, you know, an apparition there, you know, attacking her, kind of a thing. Paintings start talking to her, that kind of stuff. You know, they really ramp that up very quickly. I would change that to be, like, you know it's coming, but it was very much a flip of the switch for me, and I didn't like that. I'd rather see it like ramp into it a little bit more, because then they kind of pull it back and then go back. Like, it's just kind of a constant back and forth with that from that point on in the film. The random weird swan transformations, some of them worked really well, like on stage worked really well, but more specifically the bedroom scene, I just didn't like that. Her legs bending backwards were, like, that was, again, very solidified in the horror elements of it and less in the interesting character. It's one of the films, I think, that was cast very well, and not because the actors fit that role. I think the actors can play those parts very well. I think I would have downplayed a lot of the sexual awakening scenes. I think they just did that. They kind of circled back around on that quite a few times, and it kind of diminished. They all kind of diluted together as she's being kind of forced to grow up or forced to be an adult. They hit that point sporadically several times, and one of them is a really big scene, and the other ones are just kind of little things sprinkled throughout where it seems to diminish the big scene. I do like the symbolism in it. I do like the stories they try to tell. I do like the coming of age, being forced into adulthood. I don't like, one thing I would change is it does seem to kind of touch on, you know, mental illness a bit, but they also throw drugs in there at some point where it's kind of that mix. I don't like that as much. I think I would have more preferred it to be, you know, she's losing her mind and drugs don't play a part in that, because that's kind of where that switch is flipped, is you know, as she's becoming the Black Swan and she's shedding off her innocent self, it's like, oh, you've got to jump in and do all the things that you shouldn't have been doing. And it's just, yeah, it was less a journey of a personal journey and more of a chemically assisted journey sort of a thing.
Well, yeah, so I see that more as like a rebellion, though. Like she's like going off the deep end.
Yeah.
And I think that's what they're trying to show is she's everything that she wouldn't have done before. Now she's just giving in and letting loose.
Yeah.
And so I think that's where the drugs fall.
Yeah. And I think that's very much what they were trying to showcase. It's one of the things I would have changed where it would be nice to not see that be like, that's more of a reason. Trope. Yeah. That's the reason, like, you know, like that she did all of that rebellion without having to take a drug to really dive into it. So, but I think they also did it more for the, to break up the, her flow of her stream of consciousness, right? There's periods of time that she's missing, where she kind of comes back to reality and is like, oh, I don't want to be doing this thing that I'm doing right now. So
I thought that was most of the movie.
Yeah. They do intentionally shoot it to be very jarring to where you're like, I don't know what's going on or why or what or how or
what's true, what's not.
Yeah.
Who knows? Who knows?
And that's, yeah. It's a little too vague in that. Yeah. Where it's a little too vague in that the entire time.
I think the plot and the chain of events is a little too ambiguous or abstract. I would reel it in a little bit, connect a few more dots together and leave it less like it is. And maybe that would destroy it, but at least for me, that would be better. I feel like it's too far out there. And maybe that's why it's you being great or so good.
Yeah, no, it is a lot more concept and a lot less story and trying to ground it into reality a little bit more. It does kind of go off the rails, I think, on that a lot.
Yeah, and the fact that I can't identify with any of the characters or at least feel for any of the characters. Like, I'd care less.
Yeah.
Care less about this. Like, okay, this is her struggle, but it's one thing to be invested in someone's struggle, and it's another thing to watch someone figure it out and not care. And I'm in the camp that I didn't care with it. So that's why it was hard for me.
I it's really strange. I really do like this movie, and so there's not a whole lot that I would look at and think about changing. I would change the mother. It felt very over the top to me and very, very down the rabbit hole of the cliche of domineering parent. So I know that I would change the mother, but at the same time, it is that idea of, is it just how Nina perceives her and she's really not that controlling? You don't know, but at the same time, I also know that it helps lend to the story and it helps lend to Nina wanting to break out of this white swan life that she's been living into a more different lifestyle of what she wants and how she wants to run her life. But the mother just, I guess, turned me off. I just really didn't like how much control that she was inserting into Nina's life and how dominating she was. So I know that would be something that I would try and change. Not sure how I would change it and what direction I would have taken it, but I know that would be.
It's one of the things I think that they do, like me thinking through the final shot is probably me just overthinking it and adding more meaning than maybe was intended to be there, because they do a very good job of actually showcasing her as that controlling parent, because there's the scene when she finally says no to her mother right before she goes out on the town, like that beginning of that rebellious scene. That's the kind of scene that the kind of event that a parent has with a child who's 4 or 5 or 6, right? Those aren't adult, you know, because Nina is an adult at this point in time.
It's that delayed
thing where they very much seen that, yes, she has been controlled to the point where she is what her mom wants her to be. So
yeah, there's even the scene right before the main scene with Lily and Nina, where she blocks her mother out of the bedroom and she says, I'm not 12 anymore. You can't control my life, essentially.
Yeah.
And so it very much did portray that mentality of this mother has been controlling her daughter for years.
She just thinks she's been being controlled.
It's all because of the drugs. Her friend roofied her. And so, but I mean, it very much is that, you know, she's missed some very important developmental points in her life because she has been pushed into that idea. So
according to Lily, that never happened.
It is a very good Descent into Madness film. Reminds me a lot of Jacob's Ladder, which is more, it's just kind of the dying, the brain winding down and during death kind of a thing. But it's, there's a lot of just wait, what, why kind of madness sorts of things, which is very good. So anyway, anybody else have any other thoughts on that they want to share? Anything that stands out?
I've said what needs to be said.
All right. I think with that, we'll wrap this one up. Let us know what you guys thought about Black Swan in the comments below. Tell us what we should watch next. Tell us how we're wrong, how we're right. If I should shave my head and my beard, because every time I see my hair wild on a green screen, it annoys me. So
you should vote for yes, because that'd be hilarious to see. If anything, I'll get Russian bots to spam for yes as well.
Oh, there we go. There we go. Anyway, with that, we'll say adios and have a good one.